give you salvation just to possess it. You and I are to become the Christians God saved us to become.
Thank your pastor very much. He's a very kind man, and the things that he says, well, it is wonderful, because he is a friend, and he's encouraged so many people around the world, and he certainly encouraged Pat, my wife, and I. And when we've come here, we've felt so much at home with you people, and we want to thank you for the welcome that we've received in coming to you. We're thankful indeed for your pastor and for his wife. For all that they seek to do, especially what they've done for my country. And it has been wonderful to behold. The three who just sung have sung in my church. And oh, how wonderful they're singing before I speak tonight. And we enjoyed them very much and enjoyed their ministry in my own fellowship. You know, it was some years ago when Johnny Daniels from Puerto Rico said to me, "You know, there's a man in America that you really ought to meet. He thinks like you, and I think you two ought to get together." Well, I said, "You arrange it then. You arrange it. I don't know the man." And eventually he telephoned and got us talking on the phone, and I spoke to Dr. Sexton. And after that, he decided to come over to our conference. Now, our conference was all booked up. All the speakers were booked up. But he wanted to just come and be there. So he came, but I thought, you can't do that to a man coming all the way from America, and we'll put him on to preach. So I got him on in one of the slots and got someone else to stand down, including that was me, and he preached. Well, after he preached, I put him on again and again. And, of course, we felt so much in common. And that was really the beginning. He'd already had the vision of coming over to our country, but that was the beginning. Isn't it a wonderful way how the Lord works? In remarkable ways, in little ways, and things that we don't even think about at times, the Lord works. And now there's a wonderful work of God going on in England, coming from this place. And all the young people you've sent over, we have met them and we love them, and my, how wonderful they've done. They're all keen, they're all nice people, and have done a really good job. And I want to thank you very sincerely, and pray that the Lord will continue to do that. My country needs it. It really does. And we're so thankful. We really are. We pray for them every day, because we know that the Lord has sent them. And there's a great job going on right in the very heart of England, right in the very middle of England. It's about 130, 140 miles from where I am, but I've often been there. But they're doing a great work for God. And we're thankful to the Lord for their presence amongst us, and pray that the Lord will be pleased to continue that good work which he's done. I want you to turn with me this evening, if you will, to 2 Samuel and chapter 5. You may not be surprised that I'm going to preach from the Old Testament again. Last year, Pat and I were in Alaska at a Bible conference, and after I'd preached a few times there, a lady came to me afterwards and she said to me, "You know, you're just like an Old Testament prophet." Now, I don't know what an Old Testament prophet looked like, but thinking about it, I thought, well, I've got an idea what one looks like. So I rushed back to the place we were staying to look in the mirror, see if I'd changed overnight. But I hadn't. But because very often I preach, and I don't always, let me tell you, preach from the Old Testament, some people think that I'm just an Old Testament preacher. But the Old Testament is so full of wonderful things that so many people miss, that it seems to me that if you dig deep enough, you'll come across a real message from the Lord. And I want to try to do that once again this evening. I'm going to read, first of all, just a few verses to you, and then I want to show you a text. So we come to 2 Samuel chapter 5, and we're reading from verse 6. "And the king and his men went to Jerusalem unto the Jebusites, the inhabitants of the land, which spake unto David, saying, Except thou take away the blind and the lame, thou shalt not come in hither, thinking David cannot come in hither. Nevertheless, David took the stronghold of Zion, the same is the city of David. And David said on that day, whosoever getteth up to the gutter and smiteth the Jebusites and the lame and the blind that are hated of David's soul, he shall be chief and captain. Wherefore, they said, the blind and the lame shall not come into the house. So David dwelt in the fort and called it the city of David. And David built round about from Millo and inward. And David went up and grew great. And the Lord of hosts, Lord God of hosts, was with him. And then turn with me to 1 Chronicles and chapter 11. In 1 Chronicles chapter 11, you have a very similar story concerning this remarkable event. But you have a little bit more detail, perhaps. And so we're going to read from verse 4. 1 Chronicles 11 and verse 4. And David and all the Israel went to Jerusalem, which is Jebus, where the Jebusites were, the inhabitants of the land. And the inhabitants of Jebus said to David, thou shalt not come hither. Nevertheless, David took the castle of Zion, which is the city of David. And David said, whosoever smiteth the Jebusites first shall be chief and captain. So Joab, the son of Zeruiah, went up and was chief. And David dwelt in the castle. Therefore, they called it the city of David. And he built the city round about, even from Millo round about. And Joab repaired the rest of the city. So David waxed greater and greater, for the Lord of hosts was with him. This is quite a remarkable story out of the Word of God. And I'm sure that you've read it many times, and perhaps you've meditated upon it as well. But I trust tonight that the Lord will speak to us and challenge us each one. When we come to the house of God to listen to the Word of God, we don't want to be just educated or edified, but we want to be also challenged by the Word of God. And this is a passage which can challenge each one of us in our own Christian lives. Now, my text is found in verse 5. I'm going to read it to you again and then just show you one word. And the inhabitants of Jebus said to David, thou shalt not come hither. Nevertheless, David took the castle of Zion, which is the city of David. Do you notice that word that I tried to emphasize there in that verse? Nevertheless. Nevertheless. You know, this word occurs in the scriptures many, many times. And you will be surprised how many times it actually occurs. You, of course, could take a concordance and you could look it up and you would find for yourself. But in your normal reading of God's word, you note it. How many times it seems to crop up, nevertheless. The first time it occurs is in Exodus and chapter 32. And in that chapter, you'll remember, we have the story of the golden calf and how the children of Israel had turned from sight in the living God and was worshipping a golden calf in the wilderness. You'll remember the story that Moses went into the mount to receive the tables of the law and the instructions concerning the tabernacle. He was away 6 weeks, and during that time the people decided that they wanted a God that they could see and touch and handle. And so they apostatized there in the wilderness, and Aaron, of course, helped them, didn't he? When Moses came down from the mount, the Lord said he was going to judge the people. But he then, after Moses had prayed, promised that he would send his angel before them. Nevertheless, the people would be punished because of it. It occurs in the story of Nehemiah when they were building the wall. And you'll remember they were facing great opposition with the armies of nations round about them. And now they were accused of conspiracy. And we read this in the book of Nehemiah. Nevertheless, we made our prayer unto our God and set a watch. You may recall that Paul writes it to the Philippians when he says, I am in a strait betwixt two. Depart and to be with Christ, which is far better. Nevertheless, to abide in the flesh is more needful for you. He also uses it in that wonderful chapter of seven different descriptions of what a Christian is, writing to 2 Timothy, when he says, "Nevertheless, the foundation of God standeth sure, having this seal, the Lord knoweth them that are his." You see, the word nevertheless is a word which seems to me to be a word of intervention. Sometimes it's a word of resolution, as it is here. Things are looking bleak. Things are looking black. Things are looking improbable and impossible. Nevertheless, it was done. Because that's exactly what our verse actually says. Now, strangely enough, this is the first occasion that this word is used concerning David. Now, I know that we all love to hear about David, don't we? We think of his life as a boy shepherd, and then as a brave soldier, and then as a band outcast, 10 years in the wilderness, running for his life, and then his return to Hebron, where for 7 years, 7.5 years, he reigned as king. And then finally, all of Israel coming to make him king over all Israel. But that wasn't the finish, was it, of his life? There were many battles, there were many trials, there were many temptations. We know that David wasn't perfect. And of course, we're glad in one way that God has shown us his imperfections, because we're not perfect, are we? And if such a great man as David, a man after God's own heart, can slip and fall, so can I. But if a man like David can rise again, so can I. And it's an encouragement to us as well. But David, of course, was their most successful king, wasn't he? There's no question about that. And we know that David was a type of our Lord Jesus Christ. And when you read about David, you can see a picture of the coming Messiah and of the one that shall reign forever and forever. In fact, this story that we have in this chapter and the next chapter is a story which typifies the Lord Jesus Christ. Look at David. He's been 10 years in humiliation. He has a little bunch of followers around him. Remember who they were? They had been in debt. They were in trouble. They were in trial. They're a motley crowd, aren't they? But my, they're brave soldiers. They'd fought with David. They'd been beside him all of the way. They'd slept in the cave of Adullam. They had been with him even in the open air at night. And in the wilderness they lived. They didn't have a real place to live until they went to Ziklag. And you think about it. That's a picture of us, isn't it? Here we are, a motley crowd. A motley crowd, that's where we are. But we're in the wilderness with the Lord Jesus Christ. We're in the days of his humiliation, despised and rejected of men, a man of sorrows and acquainted with grief. That's what it is. It's the day when Jesus is rejected by the many, and the God of this world is upon the throne. The God of this world, the prince of the power of the air, he's on the throne at the moment. Ah, but listen, look at the story again. Here comes the day when David comes back and he's now going to be crowned king of all the land. And isn't that going to happen for us? Here comes the Lord Jesus Christ one day, and he will come whose right it is to reign. A crowning day is coming by and by. But my subject tonight is simply this: conquering Jebus. Conquering Jebus. You'll understand by the end of what it really means to conquer Jebus. And there's an application here, and I want you to know the application in case you miss it at the end. But listen, this is the application. Blessing can only come when Christ has conquered everything in our lives. In other words, when he is undisputed king over everything in our being. This morning I quoted F.B. Meyer, and your pastor and I were talking about F.B. Meyer after the service. F.B. Meyer was a minister in my country in Leicester. He did a wonderful work in the Melbourne Hall, and the Melbourne Hall still stands to his memory to this very day. And he also was in London. He was one of the preachers at the memorial services that were held for Mr. Spurgeon. F.B. Meyer says that one day there was a crisis in his life, and he was in prayer on his knees before God, and in his mind he could see a bunch of keys, and those bunch of keys represented, each one of them, different departments or compartments of his life. A key would open this department, a key would open that compartment, and so on. And there was the bunch of keys. But the Lord said, "Have I got all the keys?" And Mr. Meyer said, "Yes." But the Lord said, "No, I haven't. Perhaps there's another key." And finally, he gave the other key. And he was fully surrendered, absolutely surrendered. And he said, from that time onward in his ministry, it all changed. When suddenly there was a dearth, now there's a great blessing. When there doesn't seem to be any progress, now there's a galloping forward. Why? Because he had surrendered all to the Lord. You know, Jebus, Jerusalem, if you like, stands for things that must be conquered before the blessing can come. I wonder tonight if there's some Jebus in your life that's never been conquered. Think about it. Perhaps it's some lust. Perhaps it's some lie. Perhaps it's some habit. Perhaps it's some jealousy. Perhaps it's some worldliness. Perhaps it's some inordinate desire. Perhaps it's something secret. Nobody else could ever get that deep into you. And it's secret. But tonight it's a Jebus. And unless King Jesus conquers that Jebus in your life, then you'll never know the fullness of the blessing of the Lord in your soul. Let me, if I can, go through this passage of Scripture with you. It's a wonderful passage. And isn't it wonderful that we can turn to such books as Chronicles? And, of course, primarily the Chronicles are to chronicle the names and the events. But every now and then there's a wonderful pregnant statement, or there's a story which stands out, and this story stands out to me. I want, first of all, to consider with you the difficulty David faced. The difficulty David faced. Before we go any further, let me explain to you that sometimes it seems to me that it's difficult to understand. Tell me, which chapter comes first, chapter 12 or chapter 11? Well, you say chapter 12. But really, chapter 12, from a historical point of view, comes first before chapter 11. Now, how come that happens? Well, the Hebrew writers very often gave a synopsis of the history, first of all. It's like giving a page of contents. And then, in the next chapter, they would go through the full details of what actually took place. So we're looking in this chapter, which really gives the full details and something of some things, and yet the synopsis of others as well. Now, in chapter 12, you read all about the coronation. And really, you would think that chapter 12 should come first, because the coronation has taken place. What happened, of course, in that coronation, you may remember how David received all of the tribes and all of the men of the tribes. There was something like 350,000 people came to that coronation in Hebron. My, what a day they had. No, 3 days they had. There was certainly a wonderful time of great blessing. But you know, here is David, king, now at this particular point where we have our verses that we're considering together. And it was at that time, it seems to me, that he wrote Psalm 18. Now, you have your Bibles, and of course you bring your Bibles to open, don't you? I hope you do. And I want you to turn to Psalm 18. Let me, if I can, just show you one thing concerning this. This is quite a lovely thought. You know, at the very beginning of the psalm, sometimes they tell you the actual historical event, and sometimes they tell you about the psalm and what it's going to be, what sort of psalm it is. I think these are inspired. And if you look at them, you will see what I mean. It says at the very beginning, "To the chief musician, a psalm of David, the servant of the Lord, who spake unto the Lord the words of this song in the day that the Lord delivered him out of the hand of his enemies and from the hand of Saul. And he said, I will love thee, O Lord, my strength. The Lord is my rock and my fortress, and my deliverer, my God, my strength, in whom I will trust, my buckler, the horn of my salvation, and my high tower. I will call upon the Lord, who is worthy to be praised. So shall I be saved from mine enemies. You know, we could go through that psalm, and you would see what a jubilant psalm it is. And it fits in exactly to that coronation day. David is king. But let me show you how he describes himself. Again, come to the beginning of it. To the chief musician, a psalm of David, the servant of the Lord. Isn't it quite remarkable that this man who has now been made king and utters these tremendous words are in this wonderful psalm, who he could easily say, David the king. No, no. There's a better title than that. There's a greater title than that. And what is it? David the servant of the Lord. Very few people in Scripture were called the servant of the Lord. Moses was called the servant of the Lord. He brought the people out. Joshua was called the servant of the Lord. He brought the people in. And now here you come to David, who is now made king over all Israel, and he's just the servant of the Lord. You know, that's the greatest title you could have this side of heaven. It really is. Or you can give me all sorts of titles. You can talk, say all sorts of things about me if you like. But listen, the greatest title I've got is the servant of the Lord. No other title that men can give me mean anything whatsoever. Here is David, the humbled king. And after the coronation is over and David is the king, what's the first act that he does? What's the first thing that he's going to accomplish? What's the first thing that comes to his mind? Conquer Jebus. Conquer Jebus. The Jebusites lived in Jebus, and they were one of the ancient foes, and they must be dealt with. And if they're not dealt with, the kingdom is going to suffer, and therefore they must be dealt with first of all. And this is the first act that David does when he becomes king over all of Israel. Let me speak first of all concerning their story. You know, the first reference, it seems to me, to Jebus or Jerusalem is in the story of Melchizedek. You remember that Melchizedek met Abraham after his battle with the kings. It's in Genesis 14. He is called there the King of Salem, a priest of the Most High God. I believe it's one of the pre-appearances of our Lord Jesus Christ. But Salem equates, you see, with peace, or if you like, Jerusalem, because that's what the word actually means. The Jebusites were descendants of Canaan, the son of Ham, the people of Lot's degraded daughter who was born in Sodom. They were part of the Canaanites of the nation, and they were idolatrous. And they were indeed sinful in all that they did. They'd never been conquered in Joshua's day. They were allowed to coexist. In fact, in Judges in chapter 1 and verse 21, it speaks about the Benjamites who lived amongst them and coexisted with them. But for 500 years, they had been a thorn in their flesh. No, a thorn in their eyes. That's what they'd really been. Remember how Caleb conquered Hebron, but not Jebus. How Gideon conquered the Midianites, but not Jebus. How Jephthah conquered the Amorites, but not Jebus. Samson conquered the Philistines, but not Jebus. And Saul, the first king who came of the tribe of the Benjamites, lived with the Jebusites. And he didn't even bother with these people, even though they were idolatrous as they were. But it was David's first priority. We must conquer Jebus. Their story. But now let me show you their situation. Jebus was situated on four hills or four peaks. There was a valley round the bottom of the peaks which went around and down 300 feet below It was a strong fortress. It was built on a rock. It's described as a fortress here. There were walls around this place, Jebus or Jerusalem. There's always been walls around Jerusalem, you know. They were always there, and they were there in this day. In verse 5, our verse, where we have our text, it speaks there about it being a castle. And you could imagine what a castle meant. It was a stronghold, in other words. Impregnable, unconquerable, indestructible, and invincible. It couldn't be conquered. It was impossible. And sometimes in our lives, we have things which we feel we can't conquer. It's impossible. Sins which easily beset us. Sins which are deep-dyed. Sins which are long-standing sins. Impossible to remove. And we're slaves to these, and we can't get free. And yet they're thorns in our flesh. They interfere with our communion with the Lord. They stop our service for God. They stunt our growth as Christians. And they're Jebuses in our lives. Let me remind you something tonight. The Lord loves to deal with long-standing complaints. He really does. Maybe there's something in you older people, in your lives, and it's been there for years. 30 years and 40 years, and you've never overcome it. You've never had the victory. Listen, the Lord loves to deal with long-standing complaints. Look at the man born blind. How old was he? I don't know. But he'd been born blind, but the Lord loved to deal with him. What about the man by the pool of Bethesda? 38 years, and the Lord healed him. Remember the woman with the issue of blood, 12 years, and the Lord healed her. Think of the demoniac of Gadara. Luke tells us that the devils had been with him for a long time, but the Lord cast them out. And if the Lord could do that in those days, he can do it in our lives as well. Their story, their situation, their scorn, their scorn. Let me read again you to what it says about their scorn here in verse 5. And the inhabitants of Jebus said to David, "Thou shalt not come hither." Now remember what it said in 2 Samuel. We won't turn to it. I'll describe it to you. It speaks about the lame and the blind there, doesn't it? And sometimes it's a misleading sort of statement that's there. What the words actually mean and say are these. We can even put the blind there. We can even put the lame there because we don't need to put anybody else there. They'll stop you. What pride and arrogance. But many of us say that. We know that there are things in our lives when we say they're too strong even for God, too strong for Christ. We can't overcome. We can't have the victory. We can't conquer. What does David do? What does David do? Well, here comes our verse. Here comes our text. Nevertheless, this situation looks impossible, doesn't it? How can they climb these mountains? How can they get over these rocks? How can they enter into a castle? How can they enter into a fortress? Nobody else has ever done it before. How can they do it? Nevertheless, David conquered Jebus. He ignored what was being said. He knew God was greater. He had courage. He had faith. He had determination. Here's a man who prayed. Read again Psalm 18 and see him on his knees. He's a man who believes that the mighty God of heaven could do it. And surely we must do that as well. We've got to be nevertheless people. Nevertheless people. Remember the saying, faith laughs at impossibles and cries, "It shall be done." It can be done. So we pass then from this difficulty he faced to the determination that he showed. You know, David was a man of determination, wasn't he? Look at his life. Remember the story about the bear? You know, I said last year, Pat and I were in Alaska. My, what a wonderful place Alaska really is. And they told us, well, look out carefully, you may see a bear. Pat was all keen to see these bears. I wasn't keen a bit. Do you know a bear can grow so tall, can't it? Someone said 12 feet. I mean, I'm 6 feet. Where does it stand up there? I mean, a bear. And Pat wanted to see one. She wanted to take a picture of one. Dear me. I was getting nowhere near that whatsoever. But David took a bear, didn't he? And he slew it. How did he do that? And then what about a lion that attacked him? And he slew that. What about a Goliath who was up here somewhere? And he fought with Goliath, didn't he? More than that, think of the 10 years that he was in the wilderness. Sometimes he had to sleep under a tree. Other times he would be in a cave. That was luxury. Other times he had nowhere to lay his head. Where would be his next meal? Who was going to provide for him? If he didn't believe in the God of heaven, where would he ever have been? He's a man of determination. He kept going, didn't he? And because he kept going, God blessed him and God used him. So we know that he's a man of determination. And here's Jebus in front of him. Nevertheless, David's going to conquer it. David's going to overcome it. There's no question about that. Remember William Carey's words, attempt great things for God. Expect great things from God. That's the spirit that David had. Here's a man that despite all obstacles, all difficulties, by determination, by persistence, by faith, is going to get the job done. Nevertheless, he conquered. Think of David's vision, because it begins here. The vision is to unite the whole land of Israel. Saul's death had meant that the land was divided, and there was another king on the throne, you'll remember. But now the tribes are all united, and their one object is to make David king. But Jerusalem, Jebus, is very important. It's in the hands of rebels, and it must be defeated. It's been chosen of God to be the place which he's going to use. Strategically, it's central to the nation. Militarily, it's important. Historically, it will be important. Spiritually, it's important. This is the place where the temple will be built. This is where Christ would come. This is where Christ would die upon the cross at Calvary. And one city could thwart the very purposes of God. And so it must be conquered. That's true in your life as well, you see. That's true in each of our lives. Note that the city is now called Zion, and the inhabitants of Jebus said to David, thou shalt not come hither. Nevertheless, David took the castle of Zion, which is the city of David. Now, the significance of that is that this is the first mention of Zion in Scripture. Now, of course, we know that it's there many times. In fact, 151 times it's mentioned in Scripture, and then another 10 times spelt with an S. So it's 161 times. What does it mean? What does this word Zion mean? It means sunny. It means the mount shone upon. Could you imagine? Here's David. He must be in the place where the sun shone upon it. It becomes the city of David. That means he dwelt in the light. That means it's the place for the Ark of the Covenant to come back, its dwelling place. It's the place for the chosen people of God. It's also a picture for the of heaven for the believer. We're marching to Zion, the beautiful city of God. Why? Because God is light, and it's the place of light. It's a place which is shone upon. My friend, do you want to live in the light? Do you want to know something about that? You know, I love the story of Rutherford. Samuel Rutherford was one of the great Scottish preachers. But because he preached the gospel in the days when the Roman Catholic Church ruled in Scotland, he was put in prison many times. But when he was in prison, he kept on writing letters. And we have the letters today. And I read in one of them, it said, last night Jesus visited my cell. And every stone glowed like a ruby. That's the difference, isn't it? That's the difference. David's vision, David's vow. You know, we read together. He said, "Who goes to this city of Jebus and overcomes it shall be chiefest, shall be the captain of the host." And this chapter contains an account of great mighty men, Jashobean, who slew 300 men with a spear, Eleazar, who defended a parcel of land. The very sword cleaved to his hand. They couldn't get it free. And then three men who went for the water in Bethlehem. It contains the story of the man who slew lion-like men and a lion on a snowy day. And many others. Jehoiada, who slew the Egyptian giant. But who's going to enter into Jebus? Who's going to conquer Jebus? It'll take a man of courage. It'll take a man of strength. It'll take a man of determination. It'll take a man of faith. It'll take a man of prayer. That's what it will be. Ah, but he's going to be the man who will get through and receive that blessing of the Lord. C.H. Spurgeon said, "Be great believers. Little faith will bring your souls to heaven, but great faith will bring heaven to your souls." Amen. And so it does. And so we have David's verdict. Here's Joab. It's his nephew, his sister's boy. He does it. But how does he do it? How does he do it? Well, 2 Samuel tells us, it says he goes up by the gutters. Now, there was a waterway. One waterway into this place where they received the water. But to go up the waterway meant that he would have to swim actually in. The waters were so deep, he couldn't just paddle in. No, he'd have to swim in, actually, to get into Jebus. But he's prepared to do anything, to do what God wants him to. God will help him, but he must use his talents. And he does. And of course, he's the one that becomes the captain of the host of the Lord. The final thing I want to show you tonight is the direction he went. We started this evening by speaking about the difficulty he faced and the determination he showed, and now the direction he went. We read together in verse 9, "So David waxed greater and greater, for the Lord of hosts was with him." What a verse! What an accolade! Now he's entered into this city. His presence makes the difference. It was the city of the heathen Canaanites. Now it's the city of David. It was the place of a curse, but now it's the new place of Zion, the place of a blessing. It was the city of idolatry, but now it's a place where they're singing the Psalms of David, and there's joy. What's the difference? The difference is David is there. And that's what Christ makes the difference in our lives, isn't it? You see, first of all, the king rules, doesn't he? The king rules. Read again those verses and see how David rules. He's there by divine appointment. There he won the battle, and the people have accepted him. And tonight we can say with all our hearts, can't we? Jesus shall reign where'er the sun doth his successive journeys run. Oh yes, his kingdom will stretch from shore to shore. And we know that he is the King of kings and Lord of lords. The king rules. But there's something more here. The city revives. Look at this verse, verse 8. "And he built the city round about," that's David, "even from Millo round about. And Joab repaired the rest of the city." If you have a margin in your Bible, notice what it says about this word repair. The alternative rendering from the Hebrew is revived. My, how that conjures up in our minds something, doesn't it? The word repair and revive are intermingled words. They mean exactly the same. And we believe in revival, don't we? And you know, revival can only come when the Lord is king, and when the Lord is in the midst, and when the Lord is in charge, and when the Lord rules. And that's when revival comes. And we need revival. And Jebus needed revival. And they got revival, didn't they? Because David was there. And the people are renewed. If you go on to read this chapter, you will see how remarkable the chapter is. about the men of David and how they received fresh strength and help. Why? Because Jebus had been conquered and now the whole land was a conquered territory. And what was the secret? Well, we go back to verse 9. So David waxed greater and greater, for the Lord of hosts was with him. You know, we have a little island just in the south of our country. It's called the Isle of Wight. You can go there for a holiday. I've often been as a boy there for a holiday. And it's a lovely little place to go to. Queen Victoria, when she was queen of our country, always used to go to the Isle of Wight for her holidays once a year. And she used to visit the residents of that island in those days. A man came down to visit and to interview some of the residents there, some of the older people. And he came to a lady and said to her, "Tell me, does the Queen visit you?" "Oh, yes," she said. "The Queen always comes and visits me here." "Oh," he said, quite sarcastically, "I suppose the King of Kings visits you as well." "No," she said, "he doesn't. He's always here. He's always here." My friend, are you nevertheless Christian? Things look black, things look bleak. It's impossible, isn't it? Nevertheless, it can be conquered. May God help us each one.
I'd like for you to look this way, please. What is your Jebus? The area of your life are areas that need to be conquered. And we convince ourselves they cannot be, but Christ will enable us. He will conquer. Did you get that? Many times in the lives of people like the people gathered here, it is not some horrible something of commission, some sin we would easily identify with that we commit, though we need to confess those. The real villains in the stories Jesus told, in the parables of Jesus, the real villains were the people who were capable of doing something right but didn't do it, who should have done the right thing and didn't do it. It was those who know what to do good and doeth it not. And there may be areas that God has brought to your mind where this is something you should care for and you should care for and you should care for, and we just continue to neglect it. When a preacher preaches the Word of God, is always dependent on the Holy Spirit, because we can't get where God can get to in our own lives or in the lives of others. And so when we invite you to do something, when a message has been given, an appeal is being made, is to be obedient to the Lord and what He's brought out as He shines on that area and allows us to see it. Let's bow for prayer just for a moment. How many of you know God has put His finger on something that needs to be conquered in your life? Would you lift your hand? Something that needs to be conquered in your life. Let's try it again. How many men here know that the Lord has placed His finger on something that needs to be conquered in your life? Men and young men, would you raise your hand? It really needs to be given to God. You don't have to confess it to me. Would you lift your hands again, men, please? Hi. If your hand is raised, would you stand, please? How many women? Areas. It may be frustration, worry, these constant annoyances that we need to give to the Lord, whatever. What about it, ladies? Would you lift your hand? This is a kind place. Now, this is not a place to make a mockery of somebody. Would you stand, ladies? Would you be kind enough to do that? And we'll be courteous to you. Does Christ have the power to conquer it? Does He? Would you just like to leave your place and say, Lord, I'm giving this to you. I want you to enable me, to help me. I give this to you. Would you like to just leave your place? When I started going to Israel 30 years ago, I was taken to a little hole, and they said, look in there. That's where David conquered the Jebusite city. Now you go there, and they've excavated all over that part of the area. You travel through a tunnel and down into it and take the same route Joab would have taken. Matter of fact, my wife and I started down that tunnel, and if you're very claustrophobic, it gets a little difficult, and I was trying to help her, but I've been through it. I was going there in my mind. You know, Dr. Green, that was no easy task. It was no easy task. Now, they didn't walk through like we walk through today without opposition. And I want you to know that there'll be opposition to what you want to do. Real battling going on. God help us. Some of you do not know the Lord as your Savior. He's a wonderful Savior. Some of you want to confess Him publicly. Would you come? Just get from where you are. Just leave your place and come. Say, Jesus, I need you. By your precious blood to wash my sins away. May God help us. All around as the Lord speaks. Let's not be interested in impressing anyone but the Lord, just with our obedience to Him. That's it. All around as God speaks. It's a wonderful thing to see people coming, saying, Lord, thy will be done. I love this church. I love this church because Jesus loves it. And I want to love what He loves. I want us to be strong. And we need to get these parasitic things off of us that suck the life out of us. Give them to God, asking God to help us. I'm going to ask Dr. Green to come lead us in prayer as we're gathered here across the altar and ask God to guide us, strengthen us. And let us pray together all around. May the Lord help us.
Our gracious God and loving Heavenly Father, we come into Thy awesome presence in the name and through the merit of Thy dear Son, our Lord Jesus Christ. We thank Thee for the precious blood of Calvary. We thank Thee that it has washed us from our sins and goes on washing us from our sins. But Lord, as we come to Thee tonight, we realize that we are still sinners by nature and by practice. We recognize, dear Lord, that even when we've done that which is our duty to do, yet we're unprofitable servants. But we come again tonight that we might be cleansed, that we might be clean, that we might be sanctified, that we might once again know something of that blessing of the Lord which maketh rich and addeth no sorrow with it. O God, come upon us now, and grant, dear Lord, that Thou deal with everything which is against Thy will in our lives. We surrender all to Thee now, dear Lord, and we pray for that special grace, for the Holy Spirit's power, so that we may say yes to Jesus, that we might surrender everything of our lives, that there may be nothing holding back, that there may be no sin holding us back from Thee. But, Lord, we shall be Thine, entirely Thine. Take my life and let it be consecrated, Lord, to thee. Take my moments and my days, let them flow in ceaseless praise. Lord, take my all, take everything that I have, all the years that remain, all the days that remain. Whatever thou hast given to us, dear Lord, may it be thine and thine alone. Grant, gracious God, that thou wilt make us usable. We would ask to be used, but Lord, we cannot be used until thou dost make us usable. And we pray that thou wilt make us usable and then use us for thine honor and for thy glory. Lord, we live in a lost world, and round this world there are many going to a lost eternity, going to hell. But we thank thee that thou hast given to us the gospel, and we pray that we might spread it abroad and give it out and tell others that Jesus saves. Hear us now, God, as we pray, and meet with us in our need, and bless us, not because of our much asking, not because of anything in us, but simply and solely because we come in the name which is above every name, the name of Jesus, which we gladly bow to, and through that precious blood that was shed on Calvary's tree, that we might be free from our sins. Amen.